Hi, Khula Asman community. This is Mihir Arjunwadkar from Center for Modeling and Simulation at the University of Pune. I'm here to talk about this center now. So let me just use a presentation which we use for this purpose. I call it a cartoon guide to CMS. It also involves what we mean by modeling and simulation. This is our website, so please feel free to visit our website to know more about the center. We feel that this series of sketches or paintings by none other than Picasso capture the spirit of mathematical modeling. Picasso may not have intended it that way, but the way we look at mathematics is that mathematics is a language to capture certain phenomena, certain patterns in nature, patterns in data, in a precise and concise manner. Because we look at mathematics as a language, it allows us certain expressivity, and the specific context here in this series of paintings is the same phenomenon could be represented by multiple different models, just like the same bull, real life phenomenon is represented by Picasso here in variety of different ways, starting from something as complex as something here with lots of details to something as skinny and less detailed in minimal number of line strokes and maybe brush strokes. He has created a representation of a real bull. At this end you see more details. So these are all representations of the same underlying reality, same phenomenon. In his case, it's bulls. In the case of mathematical modeling, it could be a real life phenomenon, it could be a real life system, it could be a data set, a complex data set coming from some complex process originating in a complex system. So in this sense, we kind of like this series of paintings as representing the spirit of mathematical modeling. The process of turning a real life problem into a mathematical model typically involves abstraction, in the sense you only keep the essential of the real life phenomenon in your model. There is a famous joke on physicists that says that there was a horse breeder who wanted to increase the speed of his horses, and he employed a physicist for that purpose to analyze the motion of horses and aerodynamics of horses and so on. The physicist, being an able theoretical physicist, started with the approximation that let's consider a spherical horse. So, this is an extreme. This is basically throwing away the baby with the bassinet. But, physicists oftentimes begin with, physicists and generally scientists oftentimes begin with much simplified versions of the system to keep the complexity of the problem under control. And then once the simplified system is understood, they move over to more complex, more real-like models. So abstraction, which involves keeping only the essential, is an integral part of modeling, whether modeling is mathematical modeling is applied to a physical problem or a problem in biology or a problem in chemistry or in economics or in sociology. It is this underlying principle remains the same. The relationships inside the system, the relationships between various measured quantities in a physical system are typically expressed in the language of mathematics. Language of mathematics and the logic of mathematics being precise, it allows us to explore the consequences of the model in the world of mathematics and then try to see if the consequences that you work out as a mathematician or as a theoretical person, do they hold the test of reality? This is the spirit of science. It is the spirit of mathematical modeling also. Mathematical modeling is not something new, although the term seems to be used very often these days. Mathematical modeling is as ancient as the beginnings of science, or physical theories of physics, which describe different kinds of physical phenomena. Are different kinds of mathematical models for an underlying reality. Whenever there were revolutions in physics, that basically involved discarding one set of mathematical models in favor of something else which described the newly observed phenomena, newly observed data or newly acquired data in a better fashion. Once you have a model expressed in a mathematical language, you either solve it analytically using paper or pencil or the powers of your mind, or you resort to simulation and computation. I don't see simulation and computation as being something very different. Usually when one uses the word simulation, there is the sense of time flowing and something changing over time. It could be moving along a surface which is shown on the screen, a certain terrain which is shown on the screen in an animated fashion, or it could be the motions of atoms and molecules jiggling around each other, pushing each other, pulling each other, reacting with each other, and absorbing light, emitting light, transferring heat, so on and so forth. This is when one has this interpretation of a system evolving over time, one typically uses the word simulation, but it is essentially computation. Whether you call it simulation, whether you call it numerical computation, you call it numerics, it is still, at the heart, it is computation. Now the critical part of science is validating your models, validating your theories or hypotheses against the real life phenomenon, real life data. This is an integral part. It's the same with mathematical models. Here is a nice cartoon. It's unfortunately very verbose to read it out here. It's from a famous cartoon strip called XKCD. I'm sure most people are familiar with this thing, especially those who are interested in science. It's a very perceptive, all these comics under XKCD are very perceptive about different things that scientists and mathematicians have. This lot has to do in doing science or mathematics and so on. One of the key principles of mathematical modeling is what's called the principle of parsimony. If you can describe a phenomenon in two different ways, you basically choose a description which is the more concise of the two descriptions, assuming that the two descriptions of the phenomenon are equally good in some sense. So this is what's called principle of parsimony, or sometimes people call it Occam's razor. Another kind of guiding principle behind modeling is mathematical modeling, especially when one starts addressing a phenomenon which is newly discovered, where one doesn't really know much about the phenomenon or the underlying system. One kind of begins with the belief or the guiding principle that all models are wrong, but some models are useful. This also means that there can be very different, many different representations of the same phenomenon. These are all approximate descriptions. You can move from more approximate to less approximate, and in that sense all models are wrong, but some models can be useful. So as the understanding of a particular problem or a phenomenon or a field enhances or increases, that is when models start becoming more and more precise. So this process can be seen in the history of physics, for example, which incidentally got mathematized much early on. Another complementary view of the same thing is that all models are right essentially, but most are useless. So you have to kind of make a choice between models. Use a model which gives you the best predictive value, best descriptive value, and so on and so forth. Here is another phenomenon which probably is less relevant these days than it was maybe 20 years ago, 30 years ago, that knowledge was compartmentalized as physics, chemistry, biology, psychology, sociology, economics, so on and so forth, and then mathematics stood apart, especially pure mathematics. So this is a very perceptive comic again coming from XKCD. Now, mathematical modeling and computation and simulation is what really cuts across all this spectrum of knowledge disciplines, and that way it can build bridges across different domains of knowledge. You can also, building bridges is important because oftentimes one sees this interesting phenomenon where there are very different problems in very different diverse fields, but the underlying mathematical representation of those problems or the underlying mathematical model for these three or four or many diverse phenomena, the mathematical model turns out to have the same mathematical form. This is very interesting. For example, what is common between a system of three or four reacting species? On one hand, it's a problem from conventionally from chemistry. What is the commonality between this problem in chemistry and a predator-prey system, which is typically studied under ecology? So the answer is, and on the other hand, you could also consider a problem in sociology, where you could consider a complex society consisting of ordinary people, police, which represent the state, and a certain faction of rebels. So what is the commonality between this sociological system, a predator-prey system which is considered part of ecology, and a system of some three different reacting species in chemistry? So the answer is, you can model these three systems and these three phenomena using the same same form of mathematics, which can be differential equations, for example. So if you know the solution of this mathematical system in one domain, and you run into a similar phenomenon in a completely different domain, which leads to the same form of mathematical model, you could kind of borrow results from that field into this thing, and that gives you better insights maybe. So mathematics has this power of transcending through across different knowledge disciplines. That is what we are kind of amazed by. So coming to Center for Modeling and Simulation, it was this power of mathematics and computation and this idea of cutting across compartmentalized knowledge disciplines that is what led to the formation of this Center for Modeling and Simulation back in 2003. It's a bit verbose slide, but the idea behind the center is to, the vision behind the center is to promote awareness about mathematical modeling and computer simulation methodologies. Sometimes people think of computation, mathematical modeling and computation as the third principal methodology behind science besides theory and observation or experimentation. We would also like to encourage a problem-centric approach to doing science or doing engineering, or to try to address problems from fields like economics, sociology, policy making, and so on and so forth. So the idea is not to compartmentalize a problem to a particular discipline, conventional discipline, but try to address a problem using whichever tools that are necessary to address the problem in a meaningful fashion. So this compared to compartmentalization of knowledge, we call it a problem-centric approach. This is what we try to encourage. We also, in a more narrow field, we also try to nurture expertise in computing technologies, both on the hardware side and the software side. So starting with in 2003, the center has always established high performance computing facilities on the campus for the benefit of campus research community, which engages in computational research, and we try to keep up with the advances in technology aspects of computation, which involve both software and hardware. Software is diverse, far more diverse and specific to specific disciplines. So that is a little more restricted. We try to keep up with system software and hardware in a much better fashion than that. On the side of academic programs, we run two Master of Technology programs, MTech programs. These are post BE and BTech, and These days, we also take MSc students with a valid GATE score. So one program is the regular MTech program in modeling and simulation. The other one is called part paper, part research. The part paper, part research program is primarily for working professionals in either in industry or in research institutes in this country. These are broad-based, multidisciplinary, and I should mention specifically, these are quite intensive and rigorous programs. They are demanding both on the students and also on the teachers who teach in the programs. On the academic content side, these programs are founded on applied mathematics as one pillar of modeling and simulation, applied statistics as another. The debate of whether statistics is mathematics or not, I don't want to get into that. That's a deeper thing. We'll just stick to the conventional understanding of what mathematics is and what statistics is. Applied mathematics, applied statistics, and computing. These are the three methodological pillars of this program. Modeling and simulation, philosophy and practice. We try to inculcate, we try to expose students to a variety of different problems where mathematical modeling is used to address problems in different fields in a meaningful fashion. This is partly done by inviting a diverse range of people who work in diverse different fields to address problems in their own fields, but use mathematical modeling and computation as their primary tools or methodologies. And we also, there is also a kind of textbook or pedagogic component to this thing. That's a separate topic. So we try to encourage students with interest in science and engineering with a strong interest and background in mathematics. Computation is something that we try to develop here. This is a 2-year program. That's it. It's a 4-semester program, I should say. The minimum duration is 2 years. University allows a student to complete it in up to 4 years. We try to encourage students to take their own time because instead of rushing through the program in 2 years, if they spend more time assimilating it, that is to their benefit. The approach that we have, pedagogic approach, outlook on education and training and academics is that understanding, coming to a good understanding of a subject is what matters, developing the fundamental skills to learn, unlearn and relearn is what matters in the long term perspective of students' careers and lives in general. This is what we try to emphasize here. Understanding is what matters. It is not only the memorization skills. Memorization has its own little place in the arena of learning, but that is not, which is, unfortunately, that is the only thing that is emphasized in our education system, starting from early on, class 10, class 12, engineering exams and so on. That is something that we try to get the students away from. So if this appeals to you, this kind of approach to academics and education, then CMS is one place for you to consider. On the research front, different faculty at the center have their own different research interests. Conventionally, we have been focusing on one core area of physics, theoretical physics, computational physics, which is computational materials modeling, also known as atomistic or molecular modeling, which you can see as a field of computational physics. You can think of it as supplementing fundamental physical theories applied to specific kinds of systems and so on. The viewpoint that you take is up to you. Computational fluid dynamics and industrial mathematics is another area that one of the faculty members here specializes in diverse different areas. Digital signal and image processing is another area where we have an in-house expertise on. And finally, coming to my own specialty, I work in statistical science, broadly speaking. Astrostatistics is what I have been broadly working in for the past 10 years. We also have one researcher who works in computational or statistical archaeology, which again amalgamates problems come from archaeology. But because there is a strong data component, plus we don't have information about everything that happened in our history in the prehistoric times and so on, that is where she tries to build mathematical models for underlying phenomena which would try to answer fundamental questions from prehistory and archaeology and so on. There is also, what is not mentioned here is, there is also a strong component of machine learning to our curricula and also to what people do here. For example, one of my colleagues tries to combine his interests in computational materials, trying to address problems in materials science with techniques from machine learning, for example, or what people would like to call data science these days. So we try to mix and match a variety of things as it is appropriate for different fields. Finally, the center, the university has a science park, which is an outreach initiative. We have been passionate about science outreach in particular, but we have been very inconsistent in running science outreach initiatives, except for running science day activities. The Center for Modeling and Simulation hosted the science park activity and initiative initially for a few years, and we are proud to say that we have tried to support science through outreach in a small fashion, but I hope it grows in a big way. So, thanks.